बिस्मिल्लाहिर्रहमानिर्रहीम। टुडे वी विल बी डिस्कसिंग CML एंड CLL टुगेदर। द लर्निंग ऑब्जेक्टिव्स ऑफ टुडेज लेक्चर दैट इज CML एंड CLL विल बी दैट द एंड ऑफ द लेक्चर यू विल बी एबल टू नो द डेफिनेशन ऑफ CML and CLL, the clinical manifestations of the same and the investigations of CML and CLL, and finally the treatment, its complications imparted by the relapse and remissions during the treatment course of the CML and CLL, and finally the prognosis of the CML and CLL will be discussed with you and shared with you. Now you know, first the chronic myeloid leukemia. You know, from the stem cell, the generation of the myeloid series will produce the myeloid leukemia. So in this, the same case of CML, the stem cell will be transforming into myeloid stem cells, will be further differentiating into myeloid blasts, and they will divide into granulocytes and the monocytes, which are the actually involved cells in the genesis of the chronic myeloid leukemia. So chronic myeloid leukemia is a cancer of the granulocytes or monocytes compared to the leukocytes in the lymphocytic leukemia. It comprises about 14% of all the adult leukemias. The incidence of the CML a bit higher in the males compared to the females, and it is one of the most first cancers which was detected the genetic link, in which the genetic link was established, and that was the Philadelphia chromosome, which is actually a mutational chromosome. You will be learning in the coming slides that what is the Philadelphia chromosome. So remember that it was the first cancer in which the genetic link was established, and which the chromosomal mutation or translocation of the gene happened, and new type of the chromosome, Philadelphia chromosome, was first recognized. So this is the disease. Now the pathophysiology of the disease is that it is a disorder of the stem cells, and which are the general infection fighting cells which are affected or harmed in this disease. What happens that the immature cells which are produced during the course of the disease, during the pathophysiology of the disease, they take over the body's mature neutrophils. And what they do, then they impair them, or they become competitive with them, or inhibit them, or hinder them to defend the body. I mean, they hinder the body's ability to fight the infections in a proper manner. Now you see, CML is caused by a genetic mutation with chromosomes 9 and 22 in the body, and ABL on the chromosome, on chromosome 9, it translocated to chromosome 22. They fuse with each other. I mean, the BCR or BRC on the 22, this one, and the ABL gene on chromosome 9, they fuse by translocation. This ABL-BCR protein is an unregulated tyrosine kinase. Remember, the combination of ABL and BCR protein is known as tyrosine kinase, and this is the source of reproduction of immature granulocytes. So this protein takes control, takes charge of all the whole mechanism of production of these chronic myeloid leukemia. I mean, see the slight translocation or a sort of translocation of on the two chromosomes, that is the chromosome number 9 and chromosome number 22, how does it play havoc with the body, that this simple production of tyrosine kinase protein will change the whole scenario, and the immature blast cells will be keep on producing, and they will be producing the symptoms which are almost incurable till the death of the patient. Of course, the patients, they do survive for many years, but this is not a fully curable disease. So a change in the mutation by translocation on the two chromosomes produces the entire scenario by production of the tyrosine kinase protein. And similarly, the other functions include the upstream changes of the DNA repair mechanisms, then suppression of the body's programmed cell death proteins, and changes in the cytoskeletal structures. They are also affected or hampered by this translocation and production of the tyrosine kinase. Now you see the ABL gene on chromosome number 9 having a yellow color, it will be translocated to the chromosome number 22's red zone shown on the 22 chromosome. So they fuse here, so they fuse in a manner, sandwich like manner. I mean, you see there are two red bars, and in between the two red bars is a yellow bar. So the translocation occurs in a sandwich technique. So now you see the chromosome number 9 is a longer chromosome, and 22 chromosome number is a shorter chromosome. So the translocation of ABL gene to BRC or BCR gene, then a fusion of them occurs in a sandwich like manner, and this is known as the Philadelphia chromosome, and this is actually the tyrosine kinase protein. So the translocated ABL gene inserts into the BCR genes, the two genes fuse, the altered ABL gene functions improperly, resulting in CML, already explained to you. This is the same this picture showing the translocation, and it is shown by the colored it has been circulated in the picture. Now how do they present? Usually the patients are diagnosed accidentally. I mean, they go to the doctor, they present to the doctor, say fever, the doctor places an order for CBC, and when he sees the CBC, the TLC count is very high, and then he advances further, and he may place the order of, or he may advise the patient that you get done the peripheral picture, and in the peripheral picture the blast cells are recognized by the pathologist or hematologist, and the further diagnosis cycle starts. So the routine WBC test shows elevated leukocytes. It is confirmed by bone marrow biopsy and FISH test. FISH test is a fluorescent in situ hybridization or PCR that shows the presence of the Philadelphia chromosome. So basic three tests, CBC, bone marrow biopsy or examination, then FISH test, fluorescent in situ hybridization, and PCR test, which actually diagnoses the presence of the Philadelphia chromosome. Now fluorescent in situ hybridization is a technique in which the fluorescent tag DNA inserted into the cells, in the genetic material of the patient cells, and when they join, the fluorescence can be seeable, which will tell the presence or absence of the similar or dissimilar genetic material. So remember, this is a very crucially important test in the detection of changes in the DNA material. You see, it is a very fine technique, and it is at a molecular level inside the nucleus of the cells, the abnormal cells or myeloid cells, the changes in the genetic material, the DNA, can be detectable by fluorescence. Now the presence of the myeloid cells in the peripheral blood determines staging of the disease. I mean, you can sometimes in the early stages the blasts may not be present in the cells, or if present, their number may be very less. So the staging is done on the basis of the number of blast cells in the peripheral circulation. Symptoms and signs: the patient may present to you with fever, night sweat, weight loss, pruritus, lethargy, pallor, weight loss and anorexia, and finally the patient may also have lymphadenopathy and splenomegaly. This patient is having parotid swelling. You see, the diagnostic consideration in CML include that a peripheral blood smear or bone marrow aspirate can only give a presumptive diagnosis of CML. One still needs to confirm the presence of the translocation chromosome 9 to 22 chromosome. The common peripheral blood findings are leukocytosis with the left shift, which means that the presence of the immature or atypical cells are found in the circulation. The patient may have anemia, which will be normocytic normogranemia, because in the chronic diseases the anemia is always normochromic normocytic, and the patient may also have thrombocytosis in about 50% of the patients, and the patient may also have absolute eosinophilia, and there may be increase in the basophil levels, and the lab score leukocyte alkaline phosphatase level or score is also done. Test is done, and this lab score is low in CML. Now, staging of the disease. It is determined by the percentage of the blast cells in the blood. In the chronic phase, there are three phases: chronic phase, accelerated phase, and blast phase, also known as the blast crisis. In the chronic phase, the patient usually diagnosed by having 10% of the cells in the circulation and the bone marrow, and the prognosis when the patient has presented to you with the chronic phase, I mean, this is a sort of mild variety of disease. In other words, the prognosis is better, and with the imatinib mesylate or the tyrosine kinase inhibitor, the 5-year survival rate is about 70%, and the 10-year survival rate is about 30 to 40%. In the accelerated phase, the blast cells may be less than 20%, and in the blast phase, also known as blast crisis, there are fulminant symptoms. There is multiple organ involvement, and the blast cells are more than 30% of granulocytes in the marrow and the circulation. The prognosis in the blast phase or crisis phase is unpromising. Patient may die in 2 months, but the survival may be extended by offering the novel agents which are in vogue nowadays, and these are known as the second generation of the tyrosine kinase inhibitors. And similarly, some help from the chemotherapy may prolong the survival of the patient when the patient presents to you in the blast crisis. Now, the differential diagnosis: obviously essential thrombocytosis, myelodysplastic syndrome. Now, the features in the myelodysplastic syndrome, which will be differentiating the chronic myeloid leukemia, that the patient will be having single cytopenia or bicytopenia on peripheral picture examination or bone marrow examination, and similarly the patient may have pancytopenia, and there will be macrovellocytes in the circulation and Pilger-Hued cells and the bilobed unsegmented cells. On bone marrow examination, there may be ring sideroblasts myeloblasts and the metamyelocytes. Then the other important differential diagnosis of the CML is primary myelofibrosis. In the primary myelofibrosis, you will be finding in the circulation leukoerythroblasts, teardrop cells, poikilocytosis, pancytopenia, and DIC, the disseminated intravascular coagulation. So don't forget that sometimes the patient will be presenting you the bleeding or some thrombotic complications, and you will be considering it as a coagulation disorder, but actually the underlying disease is primary myelofibrosis, which is a strong contender of the CML. And lastly, the polycythemia vera is also falls under the purview of the differential diagnosis of the chronic myeloid leukemia. Now the treatment options of the CML pharmacotherapy. These drugs, they prolong the chronic phase and they increase the number of patients who enter into remission. The tyrosine kinase inhibitors are the drugs which cause remission of the disease. They are easier on the compared to the stem cell. The management with the tyrosine kinase inhibitors or pharmacotherapy is easier compared to the SCT, which means the stem cell transplantation. Now the old drugs which has now become almost obsolete in the management of the CML or chronic myeloid leukemia, hydria or hydroxyurea, which causes a cytogenetic response, they have become obsolete. And similarly, the interferons were used, especially the interferon alpha and cytarabine, which is a chemotherapeutic agent, they were used in the CML in the past, but not nowadays. And the new standard, I have already mentioned 2-3 times, that the tyrosine kinase inhibitors are actually the first class treatment options as part of the pharmacotherapy in the management of the CML. And the first drug which was invented is imatinib mesylate, and the next was the nilotinib. Now the stem cell transplantation is obviously will be performed when the pharmacotherapy has failed or the disease is refractory or there is remissions and followed by the relapses. So in other words, when there is failure with the pharmacotherapy, then you will consider the option of stem cell transplantation. What do you do? You do bone marrow, you get bone marrow from a donor to resupply the patient. It can be the only curative measure, although many drawbacks. Now, what are the drawbacks of the stem cell transplantation? You must know that the must be a good candidate for surgery. They must have a relatively short time from diagnosis to transplant. As soon as you diagnose that the patient in an adverse condition or advanced stage of the disease, you must decide immediately to transplant or stem cell transplant. Then you will be having a difficulty to find the matching donor, and similarly you will also keep in mind the possibility of relapse, and also once you transplant, the stem cell transplantation or bone marrow transplantation, always the rejection chances, like other transplants, is always there. And what you call this phenomena is graft versus host disease. So whenever you have the consideration of stem cell transplantation, always keep in mind that the graft versus host disease can a problem can arise. So keep in mind graft versus host disease. Now how to measure or how to judge the treatment? The first is the hematological response. Now see what happens. This response reflects a decrease in white blood cell count and platelets. If the patient is improving, what are the judging parameters? The first parameter is that the patient's WBC count will fall down. And similarly, his platelet count will also drop with the medical treatment. Then next hematological response in CML, that the patient's blast count or granulocyte count will go down below 10%, and as low as 4% it can fall down. The lesser is the blast count or myeloid series count, better is the hematological response. We can call it other way, that it is a good prognostic sign if the level of granulocyte drop below 10%, or it can remain in the range of 4 to 10%. Then next one is the cytogenetic response, which means that the patient should become Philadelphia negative. Now what the author says, there will be reduction or elimination of the Philadelphia chromosome in the bone marrow cells. I mean, the bone marrow should become Philadelphia free. It can be complete, I mean the major or minor. Sometimes 0% Philadelphia chromosome may be found. At times the zero will not be achieved, and the ranges may be from 0% to 1 to 34%, and sometimes ranging from 35 to 90% respectively in the bone marrow cells. So the absolute result can be achieved, similarly the relative results can be achieved. As far as the presence or absence of the or elimination of the Philadelphia chromosome is concerned, we have to keep in mind. Now it is, cytogenetic response is also measured by the FISH test and the PCR test, which I have already explained. Now in the chronic phase, patients who have a cytogenetic response have a significant increase in the survival, and they are a deterrence to the progression to accelerated or blast cell phase. Now what is the meaning of this? I mean, those patients who have a good cytogenetic response, I mean those patients in whom the Philadelphia has been eliminated from the bone marrow, they will serve as a deterrent to the progression of the disease, which means that those patients will not go into the accelerated phase, or they will not go into the blast phase. So which are the serious aspects of the disease, serious stages of the disease. So once the Philadelphia is eliminated, the accelerated or blast phase, I am explaining to you that the accelerated or blast phases will be checked. So it is also a good or better prognostic sign. The new tyrosine kinase inhibitors are the one that the enzyme that is able to transfer a phosphate group from ATP to tyrosine residue in a protein. The main proponents of the signal transduction of enzymes in body, in bone marrow, this is one of the many proteins that plays a large role in hematopoiesis. In CML, the BCR or BRCA-able gene is a tyrosine kind. I mean, the above two lines were for the sake of discussion of the tyrosine kinase, in which the ATP is blocked by the tyrosine kinase inhibitors. So you see, in CML, the ABL BRC gene is a tyrosine kinase that is constitutively active, and this produces unregulated granulocyte. So this is the main culprit. I have already explained to you that tyrosine kinase is the main culprit in the genesis of the CML. So the tyrosine, once it is inhibited, our sole purpose in pharmacotherapy to tussle with it, to fight it with, to block it by the tyrosine kinase inhibitor drugs. That is why we manage this disease with the help of the pharmacotherapy. Now the great advance in the treatment of CML was to develop a tyrosine kinase inhibitor that turns off the active TK tumor killer cells in the body. It is specific to the mutated gene BCR-ABL gene. This drug is target oriented, inhibition of the tyrosine kinase. The first generation TK was imatinib mesylate. Now its dose is 400 mg to 800 mg and it binds the closed form of the ATP sites in the tyrosine kinase, and in the IRIS study it was proved that the 97% of the patients got hematological remission. They went into hematological remission, and major cytogenetic remission was 87% compared to the interferon alpha and cytarabine. So you see the superiority of the tyrosine kinase inhibitor Gleevec or imatinib mesylate compared to the old regime of interferon and chemotherapeutic agent cytarabine. Now the IRIS follow-up 5-year survival study showed that if a patient shows a 3-log molecular response to the imatinib, then probability of progression-free survival at 4 years is 98%. So excellent result. In the IRIS study, it was proved in the follow-up that in those patients who showed a 3-log response, 3-log reduction with the help of the imatinib, then they became disease-free. They remained survived disease-free for 4 years, and the rate was excellent, 98%. The side effects of the imatinib mesylate include, most common is fluid retention, then diarrhea, fatigue, muscular cramps, bony pains, rashes, neutropenias, thrombocytopenias, sometimes the pancytopenia also, but most can be achieved with the common medications and are not a cause of discontinuation. I mean, these side effects are manageable with the supportive therapies, and you should not discontinue the treatment. You can help the patient by supportive measures. But the problem is that this first generation TKI or tyrosine kinase inhibitor resistance is a problem. That is why, now you see, this drug blocks the ATP, and rather it takes the it occupies the site on the tyrosine kinase molecule in place. It takes over the place of ATP itself. This is now, when it occupies, the tyrosine kinase can't work. It can't produce the immature blast cells. Therefore, it totally blocks the action of the tyrosine kinase. Okay, that is the mechanism of action of this tyrosine kinase inhibitors, whether newer one or older ones. Resistance problem, I have already mentioned to you. The BCR-ABL transcript has the ability to mutate and thus make imatinib ineffective. So mutation is a problem, and mutation causes resistance. So imatinib binds to the close conformation, and BCR-ABL can mutate to the open conformation. So the open, and it depends, the resistance will be dependent upon the closed and open conformation. What he says, that the imatinib binds to the closed conformation and BCR-ABL can mutate to the open curve. So it changes, tyrosine molecule changes the conformation. That is why the resistance is produced and imatinib becomes ineffective. The second generation TKIs have proved to be more potent and are in trials to determine effectiveness. They have actually been tried, and their results are far better compared to the imatinib mesylate or Gleevec. Now the second generation TKIs are dasatinib, which is more about 300 times potent than the imatinib mesylate or Gleevec. It binds to the multiple conformational states, open and close. I mean, there was a problem with the imatinib mesylate or Gleevec, that the one conformational aspect of the molecule was resistant. That is why this drug was invented, which can bind to the multiple conformational states. Therefore, the resistance is unlikely. So it is a new drug. It was approved in 2006, and many trials have been performed on it, and it has better efficacy. The other novel agent, nilotinib or Tasigna, it is structurally similar to imatinib. It is 20 to 50 times more potent than the imatinib mesylate, and it binds to the close conformation of the molecule of the tyrosine. But so far it has not been approved by the FDA. Now the side effects of the TKIs or tyrosine kinase inhibitors are: they can cause myelosuppression, which can lead to bleeding, infection, fatigue, fluid retention, headache, skin rashes and nausea. It can be used in patients who are resistant to imatinib, and note, dasatinib and nilotinib or Tasigna used newly diagnosed patients of Philadelphia chromosome, and also in chronic phases of the CML and chronic cases of the CML which are resistant to the or intolerant to the imatinib mesylate. So these newer agents are used in cases in which there is either resistant to the first generation TKI or intolerance to the first generation TKI, I mean the imatinib mesylate. So this is the benefit or advantage of the disease. Myelosuppression, which can be caused by these drugs, that is manageable to a greater extent. Now the combos of the, I mean the combination of the dasatinib and nilotinib and imatinib has proven that they do not inhibit each other. So rather they are supportive to each other in combination form, and they prove useful in pilot experiments with resistant cell clones. I mean in those states in which the disease has become refractory, or the relapses are common, or the disease is not responding at all, then in as far as the chemotherapy is concerned, you can offer to the patient a combination of the all of the threes. I mean the old version, imatinib mesylate, and the two new drugs, nilotinib and imatinib. So last drug, bosutinib, it is also used in chronic and accelerated phase, blast phase, which is Philadelphia chromosome positive, and especially those patients who are resistant or intolerant to the imatinib mesylates. So always the newer version of the drug is offered or invented when the earlier or previous drug is facing some problems, and the problems are resistance or failure to eradicate the disease. So the same is the case with the newer kind of the TKIs. The prognosis of the CML, the survival, 5-year survival of the CML is variable, and it is about 70%. Figures have been improved during the last decade due to the earlier diagnosis, improved therapy and better supportive therapy. And mind you, this is the average or median survival rate, 70%. In the different studies, it has been proved that the survival of the patient, 5-year survival of the patient, can be as high as 98%. And earlier mentioned that in the one study, IRIS study, the survival was 98%, but for 4 years. So the patient remained disease-free for 4 years, and the rate was 98%. Next is the chronic lymphocytic leukemia. The definition: it is a monoclonal disorder in which there is accumulation of the functionally incompetent lymphocytes, and they are the clonal B cells. It is also known as a clonal B cell malignancy. There is an increase in the anti-apoptotic protein BCL2, and the intermediate stage between pre and mature B cell is also found in the chronic lymphocytic leukemia. It results in the prolonged cell survival despite of low proliferate index. So the intermediate stage, I mean the stage between pre-B and mature B, that causes a serious problem to the patient when the disease advances. Most common leukemia, CLL is a most common leukemia of the Western world. It is less frequent in Asia and Latin America. male to female ratio is 2 to 1. Median age at diagnosis is about 70 years, and in US population incidence is similar to the different races. I mean, this was the epidemiology. Etiology and risk factors. High familial risk with 2-to-2-fold to 7-fold risk. No documented association with environmental factors. I mean the radiation exposure or alkylating agents, and no established viral etiology, STLV or Epstein-Barr virus etiology has been established. In the cytogenetics, the deletions are the major culprits. And now you see the deletions in chromosome 13 at the long arm of the chromosome 14 also. Similarly, deletions in the chromosome number 11 at the long arm of the 22 and long arm of the 23 also. The patient can also have the cytogenetic abnormality, like the patient may have trisomy of chromosome number 12. Less common are deletions in chromosome 17 and 6. So you see, many chromosomes are implicated in the genesis or in the causation of the chronic lymphocyte leukemia. Now you can see that the chromosome 6, chromosome 12, chromosome 11, chromosome number 17 and chromosome 22 and 23, they can found to be implicated in the production of the CLL. Now, FISH test, fluorescent in situ hybridization, I have already explained to you. It can help you in the diagnosis, and the translocation can be checked at chromosome, between the chromosome 11 to 14, and similarly the local translocation at chromosomes long arm, I am in the Q long arm, and another site on the chromosome number 11 V site. So the FISH can help you in finding the changes at the chromosomal level. Now, how does it help? It maps the genetic material in a cell, and it visualizes specific genes or portions of the genes in the cell, in the DNA. Okay, its efficacy is 98%. So it is a classical test in the diagnosis of the both CMLL, CLL. Clinical features of the elderly. Is the disease of the elderly with wide spectrum of clinical features, which are insidious, treacherous, not fully understandable. So 20 to 50% they are asymptomatic. I mean, this is the most problematic phase. I mean, the asymptomatic phase, the patient is now suffering from CLL, but he is not being diagnosed because he is not showing any symptoms. So that is why we call it as it is a disease of the elderly, which is insidious in character. The features or clinical manifestations are insidious. Then the B symptoms are the one in which the patient has fever, weight loss more than 10%, and the patient has sweating, and the patient may have night, especially the night sweating, and the patient may have fatigability, bruisability, and early satiety and bleeding problems sometimes. And the weight loss, remember, wasting with weight loss more than 10%, it falls under the purview of the B symptoms. The variable physical findings with normal to diffuse lymphadenopathy is very common, and the patient may also be found to be having hepatosplenomegaly. Infections are another problem in which the patient commonly presents with the pneumonia, especially the pneumonia caused by herpes simplex and herpes zoster virus. So the viral infections are preponderantly found in cases of the CLL. we are continuing with the clinical features. Sometimes the patients, they present to you with the Richter syndrome, which is the transformation of the CLL to B cell lymphoma. I mean, actually maybe that the patient present to you when he has already transformed into the B cell lymphoma. This is known as Richter syndrome. And when you actually diagnose by cytogenetic analysis and FISH test and peripheral test, then you and bone marrow examination, then you find out that it was the CLL which has now transformed into the Richter syndrome, which is B cell lymphoma. The patient may present to you with the weight loss, fever, night sweats, and wasting. I mean, the only the B symptoms, which are also features of the CLL. The patient is presenting the same way, but actually he has presented to you with the B cell lymphoma, and you may be disguided by the B cell lymphoma. But we actually do the investigations, extensive investigations, relevant ones to the CLL, then you will be likely to know that actually the underlying disorder was CLL, which has transformed into the Richter syndrome. And the patient may have increasing hepatosplenomegaly, which means the size of the liver may become larger. So that will be sometimes make a food for thought for you, that why the liver is enlarging, why the spleen is enlarging. And remember, massive hepatosplenomegaly or some other causes, but the CLL can also be the one in which the patient can have increasing hepatosplenomegaly, though categorically I will not say or commit that it is a disease with the massive hepatosplenomegaly, the one in which the spleen crosses the midline and goes to the right side. So it is a poor prognostic sign, and the patient survives for few months if the patient presents to you with the Richter syndrome. Differential diagnosis, there is a long list: acute lymphocytic leukemia, acute promyelocytic leukemia, hairy cell leukemia, diffuse large cell lymphomas, follicular lymphoma, lymphoblastic lymphoma, mantle cell lymphoma, non-Hodgkin lymphoma. So, meaning thereby, the contenders of the CLL are the leukemias of different kind, and similarly the lymphomas of the different kind. Now, diagnostic criteria: the CBC, in the CBC, WBC count may be as high as 5 to 50,000, and predominantly the B cell lymphocytes, and the peripheral blood flow cytometry is another para diagnostic rule in which the clonality of the B lymphocytes can be confirmed. Flow cytometry is a test in which the physical and chemical characteristics of the cells are found. So when you determine the physical and chemical characteristics of the feature by the flow cytometry, you can diagnose the CLL very easily. Bone marrow biopsy is a gold standard test which will be diagnosing the CLL. Similarly, ultrasonography of the abdomen, you may find hepatosplenomegaly, and similarly the lymphadenopathy. The absolute count more than 5,000 may be there in the peripheral when you place the order that the in the CBC examination, tell the absolute neutrophil count. The absolute neutrophil count may be greater than 5%. Now, the mature appearing B cells with less than 10% of the promyelocytes can also be a feature of the diagnostic criteria. Generally, marked hypogammaglobulinemia with increased incidence of infections. So, the patients can have deficiency of the immunoglobulins in the CLL, and that is why the patient can suffer from the infections. Otherwise, the abnormal B cells, they also, because they are generally the fighting cells, because they are dysfunctional, defunct cells, though they are larger in number, but their capability to fight the infection is poor. Their function is poor, and similarly the gamma globulin reduction can invite the infection to the patients of CLL, and the same way the CML. immunophenotyping and flow cytometry. Now you can see, you can find the I told you earlier that the in the flow cytometry you can show, you can see the structure and physical features of the cells. By the immunophenotyping you can determine the genes or expression of surface markers on the cells. So CD19 markers, CD20 markers are always found. They are co-expressed with the CD5 surface marker. Similarly, the CD21 marker, CD23 marker, CD24 marker, they may be expressed on the surface of the cells, B cells. So the weak expression of the surface immunoglobulins can also be a feature determined by the immunophenotyping, especially the immunoglobulin M and immunoglobulin D class. In the bone marrow, it is not required for diagnosis. It is recommended to estimate the extent and the prognostic implications of the disease. I mean, the disease can be diagnosed, but if you want to know the prognosis and complications and survival of the patient, then you must do the bone marrow examination. And in the bone marrow, you will be finding diffuse infiltration, then the patient has a poor prognosis. And if done flow cytometry and the patient is also having anemia and thrombocytopenia, to distinguish between splenic destruction and marrow infiltration. I mean, if the bone marrow is done and flow cytometry is done, what will be the outcome? Learning outcome will be that if the patient is also having anemia and thrombocytopenia, then you can distinguish between the splenic destruction and marrow infiltration. So this is the edge that you, when you do the bone marrow examination, marrow infiltration can be found also. Otherwise, the cells can be broken down by the spleen also. So one way or the other, it is helpful, as I said earlier, for the prognostic purpose. I mean, you will have to tell the patient the prognosis also. That is why you should do it. Now, the lymph node biopsy, it is a transformation of the check of the transformation of the CLL to high grade lymphoma, the possibility. So if you do the lymph node biopsy keep in mind that the whether this patient will be transforming to the high grade lymphoma, yes or no answer will be given by the lymph node biopsy. Other labs, the patient may be having hypogammaglobulinemia, and it is about seen in about 50% of the patient. 5 to 10% have small monoclonal peaks, and the positive POM test also is found in 30% of the patient. And the patient may also have autoimmune hemolytic anemia and thrombocytopenia in about 10% of the patients with CLL. The patient will be having Evan syndrome. So autoimmune hemolytic anemia, thrombocytopenia and combination of the CLL is known as Evan syndrome. This keep in mind, Richter syndrome and Evan syndrome, the and conformation changes or transformation to high grade lymphoma, these are the complications of the CLL. Now the staging, Binet staging of the disease. Stage 1 is the one in which there is no anemia, no thrombocytopenia, and less than 3 lymph nodes are involved. And stage B is the one in which no anemia, no thrombocytopenia, and more than 3 lymph node sites are involved. And stage C is the one in which there is anemia and there is thrombocytopenia. And the platelet count will be less than 100,000. So very simple staging, remember. Prognostic feature. If the bone marrow will be prognostic features will be predicted by bone marrow pattern of the lymphoid infiltration. And similarly, the lymphocyte doubling count in the bone marrow. And similarly, the presence of the serum beta 2 microglobulins. And finally, the mutational status of the immunoglobulin B and the surface marker 38 expression have recently been identified in the. So, if these features like the pattern of the lymphoid infiltration, lymphocyte doubling time, presence of this serum beta 2 microglobulin, and the presence of the immunoglobulin B and the surface markers 38, they are identified. These are the they can tell you the prognosis of the CLL. Now the treatment options are nucleoside analogs like fludarabine is the drug of choice. Similarly, the cladribine and pentostatin have been used in the past. Most effective in higher patients, more effective with higher curative rate and longer PFS, progression-free survival, compared to the alkylating agents. Similarly, other many regimes of the chemotherapeutic agents will be seeing in the coming slides. One of them is ibrutinib in the elderly patients, but it has got no survival advantage. Then the combination regime, different combination regimes have been given here, but the most common one is the CHOP regime, which includes cyclophosphamide, doxorubicin, vincristine and prednisone. Remember the CHOP regime, and you can serve the purpose if somebody asks you the treatment of the CLL. Recent advances are newer drugs which are used in the as the first line salvage therapy in fludarabine refractory diseases. Other monoclonal antibodies, this one is the alemtuzumab, which is a monoclonal antibody. It is used in patients who are refractory to the fludarabine refractory disease. Other monoclonal antibodies you can see on the screen, they have difficult names. Yeah, I mean, remember the term monoclonal antibodies, and the combination of the monoclonal antibodies with the chemotherapeutic agents are also have better prognosis, like rituximab and fludarabine. Similarly, again, these are the combination of the chemotherapeutic agents and the monoclonal antibodies, which are helpful in the management of the disease and the survival of the patient, and the relapse or remission phases have better outcomes. So there are different names of the lenalidomide, venetoclax and ibrutinib. So remember the combination of the monoclonal antibodies and chemotherapeutic agents. Now these are the fashion drugs nowadays, and they have better prognosis. The recent advance, Campath anti-CD52, is recently approved by the refractory CLL cases. Results in profound lymphocytopenia, both B and T cells are destroyed. So this is the most recent drug. Rituxan anti-CD20 is widely used both as a single agent and in combination with the other drugs. Finally, the bone marrow transplantation is a viable option in the younger patient. There is a durable response seen in the advanced refractory cases. So finally, as we discussed in the CML, when the drugs or pharmacotherapy fails, ultimately you have to go to the bone marrow transplantation. The same way you will have to, finally, when all the chemotherapeutic agents, CHOP regime, monoclonal antibodies, they have failed and the disease is still refractory, then ultimately you will have to go to the bone marrow treatment, bone marrow transplantation. And in this case, the autologous bone marrow transplantation using purged marrow has been investigated in the elderly patient. successfully. Now, transformation. Large cell lymphomas or Richter syndrome, they present aggressive presentation, they present aggressively, there is extranodal involvement, there is sharp rise in LDH, and CHOP is a standard treatment of the Richter syndrome. Pro-lymphocytic leukemia, which can be an offshoot problem in the CLL, there is greater than 55% increase in the pro-lymphocyte and the presence of the splenomegaly and cytopenias, and there is a refractoriness to the treatment. Prognosis of the CLL. The survival rate of the CLL is variable depending upon the stage of the disease. Staging is always crucial in leukemias, whether they are acute leukemias, whether they are chronic leukemias, and in this case today CML and CLL. So staging, keep in mind that the stage does matter hugely. So in this case of the CLL, the 5-year survival rate for patients is those patients who are older than 20 years, the survival rate is 5-year survival rate is 85%. Though the rate is high, but the years are lesser. Now you can compare this is the normal picture in which you can see the granulocytes lesser number, and in the CLL there are many the blast cells, many lymphocytes or abnormal granulocytes in the CLL. Now how this is the slight presentation of the chronic myeloid leukemia. See, the patient has in this slide complaining of the enlarged lymph nodes. Here the patient is presenting with the bleeding. Here the patient is suffering from the recurrent viral infections, and here the patient in the blast phase, the severe symptoms are produced. This is the blast phase picture, and you see the patient has cutaneous infiltration of the hands, and the patient can also have pruritus. So pruritus is also a feature of the B cell symptoms. Now, in the CLL, there are smudge cells on the bone marrow examination. Smudge cells are the remnants of the cells which lack the identifiable membrane and the nuclear structure. They are also known as basket cells. And the once you find the smudge cells in the bone marrow, it is almost a confirmed diagnosis of the CLL. So that is why we call the presence or detection of the smudge cells from the bone marrow as they are the pathognomonic of the CLL or chronic lymphocytic leukemia. Any question you can ask, you have never asked a question, it will remain my desire and the session will end. You won't be asking any question and I will keep on waiting you. Then what question do you ask me? After tailored the lecture for you, I expect something from you, but you have never responded. Neither you solve any assignments. So that is a sorry state of affairs for me as far as I am delivering the lecture to you. Thank you, and I say goodbye from Oxfordshire Trust Hospital.